welcome to the 7th lecture in this series of the semiotics of conceptual structures. In this lecture, we will concentrate on the works of Jacques Lacan, 1901-1981. In this series, there are 9 lectures, and each lecture concentrates on the work of one author, one thinker. Naturally, in one lecture, one cannot explain the methodology or the whole philosophy of Sartre or Lévi-Strauss or Althusser. At JNU, I used to give several lectures on each author, sometimes a whole semester on a thinker like Foucault or Lévi-Strauss or even Sartre. But here, these are highly condensed lectures. So, if there are some problems in understanding, it is because of the nature of lectures, because within one lecture I have to touch a number of aspects of a given author, and in spite of all my effort at explanation, there will be some highly complex notions which would the students or the audience is either supposed to know the author already, or they follow the author after listening to these concepts. Each concept requires a very vast and elaborate reading and understanding. Anyway, in this lecture on Jacques Lacan, we try to explain the notion of the structure of the unconscious. That is the main theme of Lacan's theory. In the domain of the dialectic of the individual subject's relationship with knowledge, Jacques Lacan has followed the model of linguistics and has analyzed the structuration of the unconscious in terms of the dialectic of langue and parole. You see, Jacques Lacan, who is a psychoanalyst, he tries to understand the structure or how the unconscious is structured in terms of the notions of langue and parole due to Saussure. Langue is a general corporate method aspect, and parole is the individual aspect. So, the dialectic between the langue and the parole, the general and the particular, or the general and the individual, collective and the individual. This attempt is situated between the absolute subject of Hegel. On the one hand, we have the notion of the absolute subject of Hegel and its near obliteration in the physical sciences. And on the other, see, on the one hand, we have Hegel who presents the philosophy of the absolute subject, and on the other, we have the physical sciences where the subject simply does not exist, does not matter, because he is taken out of it. It is projected in the researches of Sigmund Freud. Then for Lacan, the main inspiration is Sigmund Freud, though there are very clear departures. Lacan always said that he is his reading of Freud is the best reading or the proper reading, but like all readings, it is a very definitive interpretation, which interpretation became the theory of Lacan, which is very different from the Anglo-Saxon followers of Freud, who concentrated more on the physical aspect, the relationship between son and father, between son and mother, between daughter and father, the Oedipus complex in the more physical sense of the term. With Lacan, we are at the unconscious level, and it is more psychological, more existential to some extent. And as far as the methodology is concerned, which is common to the whole movement, which means there is a linearity and there is a non-linearity, there is a synchronic and diachronic aspect of each text or each object. And for Lacan, the unconscious is also this object of his study. He says, I mean, this is how he argues. Lacan argues that as a child grows, he accumulates a sum of significant relationships which find an important place in his unconscious. The child is born, he grows, every day, every moment sometime, something happens, some events take place. These events leave trace or traces depending upon the importance of the event on the psyche, on the unconscious of the child. Since there are large number, every day something happens, and the in a month, in a year, and 20 years, so such a huge sum of relationship traces are there. And naturally, what he says is that the we forget those events, but the events don't forget us. See, the traces of those events, what happened to us, are left on the unconscious, which at a given time, sometimes they are triggers, and then you think of something, and then you can the unconscious is structured like language in a linear fashion, like syntagmatic 1, 2, 3, 4. But then all the interrelated things, interrelated events or traces are put together and bring new images, and this is how the unconscious is structured. I mean, we will see now. I mean, I have tried to explain it in a very simple way, but it is the theory is not as simple as that. As a child grows, he accumulates a sum of significant relationships which find an important place in his unconscious. This process continues with the passage of time. Some of the signifiers are forgotten within commas, you see, by the subject, but the signifiers as such continue to inhibit the inner layers of the unconscious. You see, these signifiers, these events, these traces are forgotten by the subject, but the signifiers themselves, or the traces by themselves, they do not forget the subject. The emergence of these signifiers obviously follows a temporal order of a sequence or a syntagmatic progression. One thing happens after another. So, the process of accumulation is syntagmatic or linear. However, there is a constant reference to the past events, which manifest themselves as symbols, images, or dreams. What happens is that this is why the form of these relationships of the within the unconscious is sometimes called surrealistic. It is dreamlike. These are images. They are symbols. They are presented in the form of symbols, images, dreams. The signifiers undergo a state of reconstruction following the compulsions of the referent. You see, they keep on being reorganized, rearranged. This is the process in the, this is why it is highly complex. The things happen one after another, they leave their traces, but at a given time, from a given point of view, or from a given need of the hour, of the moment, there is a reorganization, a restructuration of the whole of the line of the unconscious, which may be stretched in days and months and years. However, there is a constant reference to the past events, which manifest themselves as symbols, images, or dreams. The signifiers undergo a stage of reconstruction following the compulsions of the referent. This structuration is a sort of a combinatory system of the type of music. When he gives a sort of analogy of music, that in music you have a permutation and combination of all kinds of notes to compose a given melody, where different units are of significance are combined with all possible permutations and combinations. Lacan says that the unconscious is structured like language. This is one of the very famous phrases of Lacan, that the unconscious, inconscience, actually the word in French is proper. Unconscious is not a very good translation. Inconscience is structured like language. Now, what does it mean language? Like any language, a language is both syntagmatic and paradigmatic. Languages, we have one word after another, one sentence after another, you see, or in other words, one event after another. But to understand these, then we have to go back and forth. That is the manifest order is syntagmatic, but the significant order is paradigmatic or going back and forth. This means that the human unconscious is not just a one unit whole. It is a combination of different elements which are structured syntagmatically as in syntax, that is in the linear, in its linearity, with its coordinations and its transformations. This is important, with its coordinations and transformations, and this refers to the paradigmatic order, the order which bypasses the linearity of the unconscious of the or the events. Lacan refers often to the linguistics of Saussure and discusses the structure of the unconscious in terms of synchrony and diachrony, or this, like we said earlier, that this synchrony is constituted diachronically. As there is a constant reference to the past, new relationships between some of the present events and some of the past signifiers get re-established. Again, as there is a constant reference to the past, new relationships between some of the present events and some of the past signifiers get re-established. The synchrony is structured like the myths on the basis of the residues of the past. This refers to also the methodology of Levi-Strauss, as we discussed earlier. And this structure is not a simple unity called individual. Thus, the relationship between the subject and the object is that of one structure with another. That the relationship between the subject and object is not just a one individual with another, but with a kind of a, it is a structural relationship, or as it has been stated earlier, analogic, structural and analogic. The psychoanalyst follows the techniques of linguistics and attempts to comprehend all the intricate relationships of the unconscious. The process of combination and substitution are observed on the basis of the parole of the subject. You see, the psychoanalyst, let us see, the subject talk, you keep on telling what happened, what happened, what happened. That presentation is, that is the parole, that is the of the subject. The subject is hidden in the parole, you see, but the subject, the real subject is hidden in this parole, and the parole keeps the signifiers intact as does any other form of expression. See, there is, what is the signifiers are there, but they are hidden and they are not in a given order, not on a given linear or syntagmatic order. Only a structuration must be deciphered. Now, the psychoanalyst has to decipher a structuration, that means have to re-establish, you have to decipher the reorganized structure or the metamorphized structure. Then this is again a very famous statement of Lacan. Man forgets his signifiers, says Lacan, but the signifiers never forget him. You see, the man does not remember, we do not even remember what we ate even yesterday or 3 days ago, but sometimes you something triggers and you remember something that the image of the table where you eat, where you ate and with whom you ate and what you ate, which happened say 5 years ago. So this is a paradigmatic relation. See, that is how, this is how the unconscious is structured. This is how Lacan tries to present. Man forgets his signifiers, says Lacan, but the signifiers never forget him. This is true both of the collective heritage of the signifiers of a culture and of the stock of the individual since his birth. Now, this is important, very, very important, that this issue is not it does not related only to individual, to man. This happens in the psyche of the culture, that in our cultural history, so many things happened in our history, but we do not always remember. Even the best historians do not remember everything, but at a given time there is a reorganization of, depending upon the need of the hour, need of what is happening in a given, some political event, some other event, and then the whole historical process is reorganized, rearranged, and it has a very important function. I mean, this is how the question is, how the unconscious is structured, how it works. The subject has to be studied as an object, that he says. The psychoanalyst lets the patient talk. He records his parole, which serves as the text object. This text both hides and unfolds the contours of the forgotten relationships or lost contacts. See, there are relationships which are forgotten or what is lost. The frozen symbols or signifiers present discontinuous entities which make no sense. See, normally there are these elements are presented as discontinuous, and they do not make any sense at the manifest level. However, all the elements of the structure of the unconscious are present in the parole. You see, the analyst has to look for the metonymic relations of the signifiers which appear at different points of the spoken chain, and also for the metaphoric relations which can be referred to only on the paradigmatic basis of substitution. You see, you have the parole, you have the text, you see, whether it is oral or otherwise. Then what is the function of the analyst? What is the duty of the analyst? The analyst has to look for the metonymic relationships of the signifiers which appear at different points of the spoken chain. This is the first order, the syntagmatic linear order, and also for the metaphoric relations which can be referred to only on the paradigmatic basis of substitution, which you have to look for. You have to see the reorganized, rearranged relationships. These metaphoric relationships are the most complicated. This is where synchrony and diachrony interact. You see, synchrony and diachrony should not be considered two different aspects, but they are always in a dialectical relationship. Synchrony and diachrony are always in a dialectical relationship, and the resultant of that dialectic relationship brings you to what you are looking for. This is where the discontinuities are integrated with the continuities. So there is you can also say continuity. You can use these two terms, either syntagmatic paradigmatic or linear nonlinear, or continuities and discontinuities. These are terms which are used by different structuralists and also by Lacan to present this theory, which you will see this aspect of syntagmatic, paradigmatic, continuities, discontinuities. This aspect of the structuralist theory is sort of a common denominator to all these thinkers. If you are aware of this, then it is easier to follow to go from Lacan to say Foucault, and you will realize that what Lacan tries to understand, the way he tries to understand the unconscious, Foucault tries to understand history. It is the same kind of thing, that in the that there are discontinuities which are very important. It is not the continuities. Continuities one can see, there is the manifest order and there is the immanent order. Immanent order is the order of the discontinuities, that is the order, that is metaphoric order, that is paradigmatic order. All human relationships are attempts at realizing one's being, one's proper place in this universe. All contacts take place in the realm of semiology, in the realm of significance. That every relationship, every contact has some significance. Now, this significance we may not always realize at a given time, but it is there. And in each of these situations, there is a confrontation of the being with the other. In each case, there is a subject and the object, there is being and the other. It may manifest itself in the form of desire or violence. Then naturally in psychoanalysis we say that how the being and the other are interrelated and how they relate with each other, how they interact with each other. And this interaction in the psychoanalytical terms is presented in the form of what is called desire or violence. The so called forgotten signifiers of the unconscious are the relationships which failed. See, why we forget something? We forget something because we want to forget something. Something that is forgotten, there is a reason for its forgetfulness. Which could not be realized. You see, this is something that we didn't like, we try to forget and then we actually forget. The consequence of failure is one of the reasons of this forgetfulness, but the signifiers never leave the individual. The point is that we try to forget, we end up forgetting them, but the signifiers do not forget us, you see. But the signifiers never leave the individual, they become a part of his unconscious comportment and are responsible for what is called the style of life or psychic comportment. The desire, this is again a highly technical term in psychoanalysis, the desire of the other is the desire to realize one's own being through the other. You see, this is what is the other? It's not, it has, the other is an object, but it is primarily the subject. The other is only an object. The desire of the other is the desire to realize one's own being. You see, it is the desire of one's own being, not the being of the other, through the other. When this desire remains unfulfilled, not this remains is always, we do not always succeed here. When it is not fulfilled, that when it is unfulfilled, it is transformed into violence. When what we want we cannot get, we become frustrated, and this frustration leads to violence, not always but sometimes. The annihilation of the other person, class, group, it depends on, sometimes there is a this conflict is between individuals, sometimes between between one class and the other, or group. This is a historical process. For example, in the in French Revolution, there are so many examples been cited by Sartre, by so many writers of French Revolution, analysts, historians, is motivated by this first psychic comportment of man. It is in this context that one can understand the structural import of the elements of violence, or as it was then called, terror in the French Revolution. This violence is called terror. I mean, this is a historical term in French Revolution. There are the red terror and white terror, etcetera. Desire or violence, however, are not simple emotional reactions of a subject. Now, this is very important. In psychoanalysis, it's not just a question of somebody says something to you and you get upset and you hate him. Now, see, in the this desire or violence, or this desire and this comportment of the unconscious is a very slow process. You see, is a slowly all the traces are accumulated, and suddenly something triggers this violence, of which most of the time the individual, the subject himself, is not conscious. Why we are not always conscious of why we act, but there are always reasons for that action which are hidden in one sense, which are there in our unconscious. See, their structure is highly complex. It is not based on simple love or hatred, which may be manifested at a conscious level. It is not an affair of a conscious level. The structuration of the unconscious cannot be so easily explained away. The psychoanalyst or structuralist tries to uncover the mask of the parole text and deciphers the relationships of metonymy and metaphor. Apart from the metaphoric complexity, the problems of metonymy are also not so easy to be revealed. It is so because the metonymic manifestation is in a chain which can be extended to extremity. See, even the so-called metonymic chain, for example, even if you go one by one, it is so long. Even within a day, so many things happen, and then there are days and months and years and years. So it is so long that nobody can remember all this. The mere fact that this relationship is syntagmatic and sequential, it poses problems of its correlation in a given place. It is even more difficult. The syntagmatic order is not so simple because it is so long. The chain is so long that it is certainly beyond our comprehension at a given time. The unconscious is structured like language, means that this structuration is non-reflexive. This is also important. We are not this process of syntagmatic structuration. We do not know. We are not aware of it. This structuration continues to take place. This rearrangement, reorganization continues to operate, but we are not conscious of it. It is non-reflexive. Language has its grammar, its logic, but it gets structured over a period of centuries. Like language, every language has its grammar, its syntax, but we don't know. The speakers of language are not grammarians. They do not know. You cannot. A speaker of a language doesn't know even what is a noun, what is a verb, but he uses. You see, it is a part of him. He uses. He is a native speaker. He uses perfectly without knowing anything about its structure, its order, its. As Lacan, language has its grammar, its logic, but it gets structured over a period of centuries, and the subject of this phenomena is completely decentered. In a way, the subject of language is decentered, and language or for that matter is unconscious or inconscience. As Lacan has rightly pointed out, this conceptualization is of the order of Copernican revolution, which decentered our earth. You see, like in the Copernican revolution, this our earth is not the center. The same thing is in the theory of Lacan. The structure revolution has decentered the subject. This is what Lacan says. The structure revolution has decentered the subject. This, however, does in no sense imply that the subject is abolished. It doesn't mean that subject is abolished. Subject is there, or man has not been given its due place in this universe. But its import lies in the recognition of the true nature of the structure of the unconscious of the subject. What is abolished is not the subject. This is very important, because generally in social sciences especially the subject is abolished, because the social sciences do not they are not interested in the subject. They are interested in collectivity, they are interested in group, in class. You see, what is abolished, what Lacan says is, what is abolished in this kind of study is not the subject, but the naive concept of its simplified form. It is replaced by the introduction of a subject of a highly complex structurality. That the subject is not simple. That is what is abolished is the simplicity or the simple understanding, simplistic understanding of the subject. The dialectic of the being with the other begins, as argued Lacan, at the stage of the mirror. Now, he calls it a mirror, that is, when a child is born, he then grows up, for the first time when he looks himself in the mirror, he looks, he suddenly realizes that it is he, it is his own, because nobody can look at himself. So, you can look through something. So, the mirror gives you the image of yourself, and then he says, this is what I am, you see, this is how I look. You see, and he becomes conscious of his self, and this is the beginning of the becoming of the conscious, because then you see through the eye of the mirror, and similarly eyes of the other. This is how the others look at you, and then there is a relationship between you and the others, you see, and this relationship begins. When for the first time a child looks at his own image in the mirror, this is the beginning of the introspection. This is how, this is the process of introspection, because this is how I look, this is how people look at me, this is what I look for them, this is what I am for them. The dialectic of the real self, the body of the child, and its appearance in the mirror gives birth to a whole series of images. The imaginary world begins to structure it. So then this is the world of the images, the imaginary, and you begin to imagine how this see it. See, the imaginary world begins to structure it. In every situation, the self is correlated with the other. You see, this is how we begin there. Then we have this, the individual, the I is defined across this dialectic of desire, which may manifest itself in the form of a passive relationship or an attitude of aggressivity. The subject anticipates on his maturity and on his imaginary project. He defines himself with this object of the mirror or the imagination that is not his self, and yet is correlated with it. He recognizes his self across this imagery. This form given by the body in the imaginary reflex may be called gestalt, or the way it structures the eye of the subject. You see, this is the thing. This this leads to what is called neurosis. The state of neurosis is a highly dense and accelerated situation of the unconscious, whose analysis can shed light on the nature of its structuration. The neurotic patient presents us with a text object condensed in time and space, and like the objects of scientific laboratory, helps the analyst to observe the fundamental problematics of the complexities of both metonymy and metaphor. You see, this is this kind of neurosis is individual and also of culture. For example, the way Sartre has analyzed the situations of French Revolution, this is indeed the problematic of the critique of Sartre, and the choice of the text object is not a matter of chance. You see, the highly accelerated situation of a revolution like that of the French Revolution, one can decipher the repository of historical symbols of the means of production of both the infra and superstructures manifest in collective and individual consciousness. This is how we try to understand this methodology. With this methodology we understand Lacan's understanding of individual neurosis can also shed light on collective neurosis. Thank you.